I'm on a 700-mile road trip with my former boss, a guy named Jay Coogan. Jay runs the Minneapolis College of Art and Design. That's not really important, but we're going to come back to him at the end. We are driving up to Grand Rapids for work to stay on a cabin on Jay Gould Lake. Jay Gould, by the way, was a notorious robber baron, a railroad developer, and giant corporate douchebag of the Gilded Age. So why is there a lake named after this guy in Itasca County? I've never actually found an answer to the lake question, but instead I found the story I'm telling you all tonight. Minneapolis in 1871 had a population of about 20,000 people. It had been a city for 4 years, and the social scene was dominated by families with names like Pillsbury, Dunwoody, Morrison. Now, onto this scene arrives a Scottish noble by the name of Lord Gordon-Gordn. He starts spending money like it's going out of style, and he soon becomes the toast of the town. There's just one catch. He's not actually a Scottish lord. He is a con man who is on the run after swindling a bunch of jewelers in the UK. Quick side note, as convincing criminal aliases go, Lord Gordon-Gordn is an aggressively shitty choice. No one is named Gordon-Gordn in real life. I mean, fuck me, come on. Anyway. Lord Gordon-Gordn goes on a lavish tour of the state. He goes up to Ottertail County, where he says he's going to buy 50,000 acres of land for his fellow Scots to farm. And he leaves Minnesota at the end of 1871 on very good terms, and he heads to New York. It's in New York that he meets Jay Gould. Now, Jay Gould is fighting for control of the Erie Railroad Company, and he's losing. So it must have seemed like good luck when Lord Gordon-Gordn appeared and said that he owned enough stock in the Erie Railroad Company for Gould to regain control. Gould agrees to pay Lord Gordon-Gordn $1 million bribe, that would be $20 million today, in exchange for rights to buy the stock. Now, of course, Lord Gordon-Gordn has no such holdings, and Jay Gould quickly becomes suspicious and files a lawsuit. Bail is set at $37,000. Lord Gordon-Gordn has a friend of his pay it for him. He actually testifies in his own defense on the stand that he's innocent, but he senses that he's about to get caught, so he takes the money and runs, eventually landing in Winnipeg. In the summer of 1873, Minnesota's up in Winnipeg see Lord Gordon-Gordn, and word quickly gets out about the con man's whereabouts. The mayor of Minneapolis, with Jay Gould's support, puts together a posse that includes two future governors and three future members of Congress. The posse heads up to Winnipeg, kidnaps Lord Gordon-Gordn, is going to bring him back to trial for the U.S., and is stopped 100 yards short of the border. They are all thrown into jail. One of them sends a telegram back to Minnesota that says, "I'm in a hell of a fix. Come at once." Lord Gordon-Gordn escapes once again. Now, Minnesota Governor Horace Austin is absolutely furious because the Canadian court refuses the posse bail, and this triggers an international incident. So Horace Austin calls for the Minnesota militia to stand ready to invade Canada. The St. Paul paper supports such an invasion. The Canadian Prime Minister is sending coded diplomatic messages back and forth. Now, eventually they resolve it. When they have a trial in September of 1873, the entire posse is found guilty, but sentenced to 24 hours in jail. So peace reigns once again between the great nations of the United States and Canada, but all the press reaches to Edinburgh, which is the home of Marshall and Sons, the jewelers that Lord Gordon-Gordn had previously swindled for £25,000. The jewelers hire detectives to track him down and bring him back to stand trial in the UK, and the detectives find Lord Gordon-Gordn in Toronto in 1874. Now, accounts vary on whether this next part actually happened, but at least some reports say that the night before he was due to be deported, Lord Gordon-Gordn threw this amazing going-away party where guests had free-flowing champagne, an excess of food, personalized parting gifts, and then at the end of the night, Lord Gordon-Gordn goes up to his room, closes the door, takes out a pistol, and shoots himself in the head. Thus ends the career of one of history's most notorious con men. To this day, we only know him by his aliases. Those include the Honorable Mr. Herbert Hamilton, Lord Glencairn, and the completely shitty and fake-sounding Lord Gordon-Gordn. Now, that would be the end of this story, except for this last part. Remember at the start I said I was driving with my boss Jay up to Grand Rapids? He listened to me tell the same story that I've just told all of you, and he doesn't say anything the entire time, but when I get the end, he looks at me and he says, wait for it, "My father's name is Gordon-Gordn Coogan."